Live from St. George's Anglican Church in the heart of Savlamar, Westmorland, where the official funeral for the late Agriculture Minister, the Honorable Roger Clarke, will take place in just a few minutes.
The atmosphere here at the St. George's Church is understandably somber, but it is also mixed with a great deal of excitement because the people here are wanting to express their own condolences, their own share in the grief at the sudden passing of this beloved Minister of Agriculture. However, it's a small church, relatively speaking. The seating inside here is about 600, and we can see that all seats are taken. Here inside the church, the Governor General has just made his entrance and is greeting those in the immediate vicinity around him before he takes his seat. The congregation is standing in paying proper due respect to the head of state.
Right, right. And as we saw there, Errol, yes, the Governor General greeted Roger Clarke's widow and other members of his immediate family. And while the feature was being played, we saw the bearer party furnished by the Jamaica Constabulary Force bring the casket into the St. George's Anglican Church. And indeed, that is where our broadcast is coming to you from. Good morning again to our viewers on television, to those who have joined us via live stream on the Jamaica Information Service website, jis.gov.jm. My name is Stacey Ann Smith.
And I'm Errol Lee. And as we await the beginning of the series of tributes, how many tributes do we have lined up, Stacey Ann?
We have quite a few, certainly from the Westmorland Parish Council. That's Roger Clarke's home parish. And the St. Elizabeth Parish Council. There will also be a tribute from the Ministry of Agriculture delivered by the Permanent Secretary, Mr. Donovan Stanbury. And we will also hear tributes from the Jamaica Labour Party as well as the People's National Party.
And
there will also be musical
tributes,
as well.
Which we have been hearing so far. Featuring Dwight Richards on his trumpet and Kevin Williams, one of Jamaica's noted tenors. They have been keeping us entertained, so to speak, while the dignitaries file into the church.
Right, and among those dignitaries, we just saw a shot of our most honorable Prime Minister, and we go now to the officiating clergy for
this
the start of the ceremony.
The official start of the funeral of our late brother, the Honorable Roger Clarke. We're having a number of tributes, and I need to say to those who are making those tributes that there will be no need to go through the usual protocol. We get up here, we say good morning, and we say what we have to say within 5 minutes. Within 5 minutes. And each person has already committed himself, herself, to ensure that we last no longer than 5 minutes. I must tell you that I am under obligation from Mrs. Sonia Clarke. She wanted this funeral service to last no longer than 2 hours. We were able to stretch her to 2.5 hours. She says after 2.5 hours, she's going to take her husband and she's going home. So I'm imploring everybody, those persons who have the privilege to speak, to ensure that your work within the confines of the time. Thank you very much. The first speaker, who will be the one to set the pace and to lead by example, is the Permanent Secretary, in the Ministry of Agriculture and Fisheries. I know that in that department there would be much to say, but today all will have to be said in a condensed and succinct way. So I now invite Mr. Donovan Stanberry to now make his tribute. Mr. Stanberry. And there's no need for you to applaud him, no matter how handsome he looks.
Thank you very much. We choose today to remember Minister Roger Clarke, not by listing his numerous accomplishments as Minister of Agriculture and Fisheries, which will be appropriately documented somewhere, but rather to remember him for how he interacted with us and how he touched the lives of the farmers of this country. As Minister, Roger Clarke was totally unconcerned about the trappings of the office and was never consumed with a sense of self-importance. Although having a large, imposing frame, his demeanor was never intimidating. He had an amazing capacity to put you at ease and was the most engaging person I've ever known. He threw himself into his work with a passion that can only come from someone who genuinely knows and enjoys what he's doing. It was that passion that inspired us, along with his clear vision of where he wanted to take the agricultural sector. It was therefore natural for Minister Clarke to join forces with the JAS in 2003 in the Eat What You Grow campaign. He told me several times that nothing turns a man more than to see farmers prospering. And conversely, nothing irritated him more than when he was hounded for permits, especially chicken back. He would say, it's because I don't know, you know. When people talk about import permits, it's like a red flag flash across my face. The relationship between red flags and red pole bullies. Although Minister Clarke had a great practical experience in the sector, he allowed his technocrats to do their work at the policy level. So he never surrounded himself with a battery of advisors, but inspired his technocrat to achieve the greatest. So he referred to his staff as the greatest conservator of forests, the greatest director of veterinary service, and of course, the greatest permanent secretary in the Western Hemisphere. That was his word. His genuine love for farmers, ladies and gentlemen, is unquestioned and unparalleled. Minister Clarke would never take a journey from St. Elizabeth to Kingston without spontaneously stopping at some farm and engage the farmer. And we learn from him to respect the farmers, because for him, the farmers of this country were the salt of the earth. He spent many hours brokering agreements, settling disputes between farmers, exporters, farmers, importers, big farmers, small farmers, Kong people. And in these sessions, he used his characteristic wit to his advantage. In one such session, he was trying to settle yam prices. And the farmer bawled out, "Minister, it's $35 a pound I'm getting for my yam." But the minister knew that the price was cyclical and you have to calculate your profit based on averages. So Minister Clarke asked him, "How much you get for yam last year, August?" The farmer said, $100. He said, "Why you never called me that time? You only invite me to the funeral, but you don't want me at the wedding." One of the first things I learned from Roger Clarke was his capacity to remain focused in the face of his detractors. I was struck on entering his office for the first time that he had on the wall framed copies of the various cartoons in which he featured. And alongside those, a list of ministry and constituency priorities. And I was really amazed that the very objects that sought to ridicule him, he used it to be trophies. He was the doyen of ministers of agriculture and the CARICOM, and we salute the minister from Barbados here with us today, and we won't go on into that. Ladies and gentlemen, Minister Clarke was devoted to the cause up to his death. The night before he was supposed to come home, he called me and he was telling me his renewed resolution to throw himself into the business in order to consolidate his legacy. The irony has not escaped us, ladies and gentlemen, that in the departure lounge, heading home, his creator called him to another departure lounge, the sleep of death, where he's awaiting his resurrection. We honor his memory by committing to build on that strong foundation. Thank you.
And that was the permanent secretary of the Ministry of Agriculture.
Thank you very much, Stanbury.
Donovan,
then we'll have
Stanbury.
Mr. Paul Wilson.
We now await a tribute from.
He's a smaller man. I can manage
Westmoreland
him better.
Parish Council. And this will be delivered by Councillor Paul Wilson. And he represents the Froome Division.
Morning, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. It is indeed a privilege to give tribute to the Honorable Roger Harold Clifford Clarke, a man who has embodied so many fine attributes. These he displayed in a manner that was inspirational, so much so that some of us attempted to do it like Roger, or more wisely, decided to leave it solely to Roger. I want to say thanks to the Honorable Roger Clarke for these attributes. One is genuine love and compassion that he has shown to the less fortunate. And I can recall one Friday on his regular constituency visit, after allocating the funds that were available, a old lady came in and he said to her, "The funds are done. I will see what can be given next month." The lady sat there in silence and stared at him, and he stared back. And he leaned back in his chair and said, "Dan, go in my van and pass the checkbook for me." Dan carried the checkbook and he bent over and he did his usual personal givings. When he raised his head to hand the check, tears filled his eyes and we heard him mutter, "You could be my mother." But his compassion for the less fortunate, he also used that and embraced his counselors, because he, as a former councillor, understood the rigors of representation at the local level. He really made us feel to be part of his family, and that is why he called us his sons. And there are 5 sons that he has left here in central Westmoreland: Councillor Thomas, Councillor Miles, Councillor Van Riel, Councillor Gordon, and myself. We miss our father. But I want to thank him also for demonstrating to us his sons his inclusive style of management. He always consulted his councillors to know what is happening on the ground. He treated all councillors equally. He demonstrated, despite his senior age, an energy level that is enviable by some half his age. Fridays was Roger's day in central Westmoreland, and the entire parish of Westmoreland knew that. So much so, we had constituents from elsewhere converging on his office. He did not see party lines. I can recall, and my brother councillors are here to attest to it, There was an occasion that a gentleman came in, and when he sat, his first declaration was that, MP, may I labor right, you know? Roger said, that is not what you're here for. I am MP for everybody. And that is another reason why thousands turned out last night to pay farewell to the man who has extended such broad love for his people. But he has a vision and a passion for education. And some of the monuments that he will be leaving behind for us to treasure for many years are the 6 basic schools that he has totally rebuilt. He will be remembered for his contribution each year in education grants. Each year, some $4 million is allocated to education. And this year, just before his departure, at his home, we decided as a family to establish the Roger Clarke Scholarship, by which 20 students at the tertiary level benefited. Ladies and gentlemen, I wish to close by thanking the man for his personal guidance he has given to me, going back as far as 1998 in the sugar industry. And then again, when I decided to enter political representation in 2007. When the wolves were at my feet and friends were few, he stood there with me. When some had doubt of my ability to bring home from division, he in no uncertain manner in a meeting declared, if Paul can't win from, the man to do so don't born yet. And he gave me a lift, and I thank him for allowing me to stand tall on his own shoulders. On behalf of the people of Westmoreland, I wish to thank his wife and family for giving us such a great man. Thank you, Sonia.
That was Councillor Paul Wilson.
His Worship the Mayor.
Speaking on behalf
Councillor
of
Fisher,
of
Mayor of Black River,
and the
will
next
now speak.
Will come
he too
from the
will
Mayor
understand the importance of brevity.
Councillor Everton Fisher, who will speak on behalf of the St. Elizabeth Parish Council, which Roger
towards
wants
that pure and holy city, oft your longing eyes you cast. Now Jesus whispers sweetly to you, Roger, heaven is yours when earth is past. Today we come with our hearts broken to bid final farewell to our father, legend and patriot, Roger Harold Clifford Busher Clarke. Over 40 years ago, the people of St. Elizabeth welcomed and adopted this Westmoreland as our own. Roger made St. Elizabeth his home to the point where many people did not know he was not from the parish. He started from humble beginning, working as a busher on the Appleton estate. There he intermingled with people of different social and economic status, and would never fail to acknowledge his employers, whether it was lady in the office, a farmhand, or a tractor driver. Roger was a supporter of women's rights. As a busher, he fought for the ladies to get work on the estates. He believed in the importance of small farmers to the Jamaican economy and was an advocate for them. His experience on the estate helped to mold him into a humble, dedicated worker, politician, and human being he was. In 1986, there was a crisis in the Balaclava Division. This People's National Party loyalist entered the political arena and was elected councillor. He was also elected mayor of Black River and chairman of the St. Elizabeth Parish Council. As a member of parliament for Northeast St. Elizabeth, this giant helped to transform the entire parish of St. Elizabeth, and his leadership qualities were exemplary and incomparable. His love and affection for the people was genuine and evident. His ability to interact with people, regardless of their political affiliation, race, and status, was exceptional. After trading political barbs and almost knocking fists with his political opponent, Basil Peril, in one of the general elections, 2 weeks later, they could be seen playing dominoes at Braes River Square. On one occasion on his way home as a mayor, the car broke down in Holland. Ironically, he was rescued in Holland by the JLP MP, Mr. J.C. Hutchinson, who gave him a lift home. He stopped at every bar they passed, introducing J.C. as his campaign manager. Everyone knows J.C. was his political opponent. Many persons criticized him for handouts, but he believed in self-development, especially to the small farmer, small person. His contribution of chicken and fertilizer to poor persons and farmers to give them a hands up was limitless. I am not sure many persons recall, but there was a time when the Black River Hospital was going to be relegated. Roger and Donald Buchanan was not supportive of this move, and they organized a demonstration with the people of Black River. And that time, the Prime Minister was then Prime Minister P.J. Patterson. He had to flew down from Kingston to address the matter. The hospital was upgraded, and as a result of the protests today, this service there is more than beneficial to many. Every person in this parish who ever met Roger will tell you that he left an indelible mark on their lives. This kind-hearted man was won for himself the love and admiration of the people of St. Elizabeth. And so, Master Raj, Busher, Roger, Minister, Member of Parliament, today we bid you final farewell. Time will never permit me to explain how much you have touched the lives of the people of this parish. You will always be remembered, and you will always treasure the service that you gave to this beautiful parish. This void will never be filled in this lifetime by anyone, no matter how hard they will try. So from the hills of Balaclava, Eldersley, stretching towards the plains of southern St. Elizabeth, to the beautiful sea of Treasure Beach and Black River, we proudly salute you. On behalf of our past and present members of Parliament, past and present councillors, workers, political allies from across the different political spectrum, the farmers, the housewives, everyone, no matter how their economic or social status, we thank God for lending you to us and for Sonia for sharing you with us. And so, we love you always, Roger. May the angels lead you to that new and holy city, Jerusalem. May God grant unto your soul eternal rest.
No announcement needed.
Good morning, church. As we pause to reflect on the life of Roger Clarke and to bid him farewell, let us give God thanks for having allowed us to share him for the last 74 years. Sonia, I know that you can be comforted in the knowledge that you had the great privilege to be with someone who was your soulmate for the better part of 40 years. Andrew, your father was the real deal. And we often talk about Brand Jamaica. Roger Clarke, as far as I am concerned, was the manifestation of what we mean by Brand Jamaica. Jamaica was reflected in all of the style and content of Roger Clarke's life. His generosity of spirit is legendary. And the thing that impressed me most about him was his consistency. In and out of office, Roger was the same Roger anywhere you met him. He extended himself on every occasion, particularly with respect to the farmers of the country, and especially the small farming community. But you know, in addition to all of that, in addition to his great wit and mighty stature, Roger was in his heart a very gentle and soft person, and an emotional person, given to emotional response whenever anything serious affected him or anyone within his family. His love of the women folk and the respect and admiration for this fairer sex was manifested perhaps in the way he treated them in his daily life. I remember only so well, he called me shortly after the operation and he said, "Mascal, you would not believe it, but I took a walk this morning on a liquor stroll, stroller. I said, "But Roger, you couldn't possibly do that on your own." He said, "No, I had some assistants, nursing staff, etc." I said, "How are they treating you?" He said, "Oh, lovely." I said, "Have you met any Jamaican nurses?" He said, "Oh my God, don't talk about those. I feel completely at home." He reserved, however, a very special place in his heart for two very special women. And he never failed on every occasion to remind us of the degree to which he respected them, honored them, and loved them. First, I refer to his dear wife, Sonia. Sonia, Roger loved you to the point of worshiping the ground you walk on. And he wasn't fearful of communicating that to his friends. Always full respect and love and appreciation for being by his side as a soulmate, right to the very end you were indeed. I think it must be the greatest privilege a leader can have, to have someone who offers love, affection, and undying commitment. And that is what he offered to our present Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Portia Simpson Miller. Roger loved her in an uncompromising way. Without commitment, he would do everything to ensure that she comes out on top. And I can tell you, we had many conversations, as we always did. In fact, we even spoke on election day. And of course, he would mouth me and say he's going to beat me up, and I would return the favor. But every time we spoke about the Prime Minister, his comrade leader, it was a special type of discussion. Prime Minister, Roger Clarke honored you, loved you, and respected the ground you walk now. Roger Clarke taught us one very important lesson. And we all, as politicians at times, having been elected and made ministers of government, tend to forget a lot of things. Roger Clarke taught us not to take ourselves too seriously, not to feel that what is there today is there forever, but to live as if tomorrow you would need to reflect on your stewardship of today. I've never forgotten conversations relating to that. And he was always so full of condemnation for those who did not act sufficiently, even-handedly. And so, Roger, so long, my friend. It should really be sufficient for me simply to say, Roger Clarke was my deepest and dearest friend. May God bless you real good, Roger. God bless.
And a moving tribute from Carl Samuda, representing the Jamaica Labour Party. And we now await a tribute from Roger Clarke's own party, the People's National Party, to be delivered by party chairman, the Honorable Robert Pickersgill.
From my vantage point here, if Roger were here, he would say you all look good this morning. What can I say about our beloved Vice President Emeritus? Comrade Roger Clarke, that many of us gathered here do not already know. I recall him saying, and let me quote, if you want a big funeral, you must live good. And as I look around at the sheer numbers of people paying their respects, their last respects, including last night, I can see that that statement is being played out here this morning. But whatever name he was known, or rather, but whatever name he was known by, Comrade MP, Minister, Farmer, Red Pole Bull, Busham, Roger was a unique individual who stamped his own signature style on the service he rendered to his party, his fellow Jamaicans, and to his country. However, as chairman of our great party, I will confine my tribute to the invaluable political work Roger did for the party. It is important to note that in representational politics, he climbed the political ladder first as a councillor, then as a mayor, then as member of parliament, a minister of state, and finally as minister. Indeed, he acted at least on one occasion as the head of the government. In characteristic style, Roger said of that particular achievement, one day Bishop, same Bishop. Let me now highlight his career in representational politics, which started in 1986 and ended in 2014. During that time, he was elected as councillor for the Balaclava division twice. The first time was in 1986, then again in 1990. Roger was elected mayor of Black River and chairman of the St. Elizabeth Parish Council. He also served as the chairman of the Association of Local Government Authorities, ALGA. He then moved up the political ladder and was successful on six successive occasions as a member of parliament. All told, he faced the electorate on eight occasions, both at the divisional and constituency levels. He was successful on every occasion. When he thought that he was going to hang up his political representational hat, he was asked by the president of the party at short notice to go to the parish of his birth and to represent Central Westmoreland, the constituency he represented up to the time of his untimely death. Of course, this did not put an end to his winning ways. Indeed, we in the PNP have accorded him the accolade of a six-star general, a truly well-deserved designation. On several occasions, he received over 10,000 votes at the polls. Several occasions. Cumulatively, during his 28 years of representational politics, more than 51,000 voters cast their vote for Roger Clarke. These results are not mere statistics. They are testimony to his larger-than-life personality, his affable, jovial nature, and his genuine love, interest, and care for the people. Not only whom he represented, but across the length and breadth of Jamaica, many of whom are here today to say their goodbyes. Not many political candidates can boast of a record like his. In the meantime, his success at the polls was matched by his political advancement within the ranks of the PNP. He became the chairman of Region 6 and was a vice president and treasurer of the party. Up to the time of his death, he was vice president emeritus of the party. Roger won the love and respect of all whom he encountered across the political divide, as you can see here this morning. He was a champion of the powerless, a great parliamentarian, an astute debater, and a visionary politician. I have no doubt that when St. Peter receives Roger at the pearly gates and he meets those indomitable comrades of blessed memory, Michael Manley, Howard Cook, and Donald Buchanan, in true Roger style, with grace, wit, and charm, I'm sure that he will say to them, "Since you left, we have been returned as a government under the leadership of your beloved Portia. We also have a new general secretary, and he has even promised to purchase and wear a new pair of shoes." And I'm sure he's going to tell them that DK is still wearing a jacket. I can see them now, their faces creasing into appreciative smiles of camaraderie, comradeship, and love. Before I conclude, on a personal note, let me say that whenever Roger and I and others in the audience, the Chancellor himself, after executive meetings, were gathered at a movement we call the University, as it approached 11 p.m., he would make a call and hand me the phone and say, "Speak to the wifey." The charming voice of Sonia would be at the other end. I came to realize that he was constantly in touch with her and that he wanted her to know that he was not up to any mischief. Whenever I handed him back the phone, he would say, "That the woman no have no equal. I don't know what I'd do without her." Ladies and gentlemen, I concur with that sentiment. Sonia, he loved you, and he loved his family. We at the PNP vow to protect you and to be at your service in whatever way we can. I know that you will take refuge in the Lord and cast whatever burdens you may have upon him. Roger, you have walked with kings, but you never lost the common touch. Your passing has left a void that will be hard to fill. Many hearts are grieving today, and many eyes are filled with tears. Yet, at the same time, many are giving thanks to the Almighty that he loaned you to us for over 70 years. Walk with the angels, my colleague, comrade, and my friend. May his soul rest in peace.
That's a tribute there from Robert Pickersgill, chairman of the People's National Party. Next, we will be having a musical tribute by Dwight Richards, trumpeter and soloist. He entertained us while we were waiting for the sanctuary to be filled by all the dignitaries who are now in attendance. And so far, if you're just joining us, we have had tributes from Donovan Stanbury, Permanent Secretary, Minister of Agriculture, Councillor Paul Wilson of the Parish
and
Council,
now
and now Dwight Richards.
The end is here, and so I face my final curtain. My friends, I say it clear and state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I've traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. I've planned each charted course, each careful step along the byways, and more, much more than this, I did it God's way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you all knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there were doubts, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed, I've cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that. And may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man, what has he got, if not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record show, brother, you took your blows and did it God's way. Yes, it was God's way.
A beautifully delivered tribute by Dwight Richards, who is very popular for his skills on the trumpet.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
But we were treated to his vocals this morning.
Today is a very sad day.
We now hear tributes from members of Roger Clark's family,
who passed away so suddenly. Needless to say, it was a shock to everyone, both locally and internationally. I stand here today in grief and pain to say goodbye to someone we so dearly loved. I do so on behalf of all my siblings, Marion, Teresa, Janet, Judith, Donnelly, Dorrit, and of course, Winston. At an early age, Roger has been very industrious, working in the fields with his parents and grandparents in Glenelly, Westmoreland, where he was born. It is not surprising, therefore, that he became one of the biggest farmers in the country. He eventually entered politics, and his natural love for people and agriculture, he grew as he climbed the political ladder from councillor in the parish of St. Elizabeth to Minister of Agriculture and Fisheries and Member of Parliament for Central Westmoreland, up until the time of his death. The shock and disbelief experience is still unexplainable. Today, we continue to mourn and grieve for our dear brother. But all of us have come to realize that Roger possessed one of the most extraordinary gifts ever. That is, his uncanny ability to make people laugh, feel wanted, and feel loved around him, often quite easily and skillfully, turning criticism and ridicule on its ugly head. He committed himself to serving the people of Jamaica, and in particular, the agriculture sector, and did so in commendable style. Not only was this trait so innate to the core of who he was and as a person, but it is unconditionally authentic. Roger's wit, warmth, good-naturedness, and love for people was a rare and magical gift. There are many fond memories of him we could recall. The good times we had when amidst his busy political life, he made time for togetherness, especially on special occasions like birthdays and anniversary celebration, and even played a role of giveaway father for his younger siblings. We could always sit down and talk to him about our challenges and plans. Roger was a character. He always had a glowing smile on his face and always seemed to have a new joke to tell. He said he had a book of jokes, which we thought was a joke, but it was not a joke. His easygoing, relaxed nature made him a delight to be around, but he also had a serious side to him, his success as a politician. Our brother was one of the most affable politicians Jamaica has ever seen. His life was characterized by genuine, heartfelt love for all mankind. Already, the outpouring of love is evident here today. It was a life of political benevolence and unselfishness. He lived for the people. His invaluable contribution to nation building and tremendous sense of duty to public life have left an indelible mark on all those who knew him. We can truly say today that he was an outstanding and accomplished person. For his siblings, his joy, pleasure, and pride of being with us will remain steadfast and timeless. This is something that will bring us peace as the days we are on. We believe that whenever we are in grief of not being able to hear his voice or see his face, or when that feeling of emptiness creates that void in our hearts, the good times spent with our dearly beloved brother will soften the pain. Already, we are fully aware that letting go will be one of the biggest challenges to face. Right now, it seems almost impossible. We are still in disbelief. It's almost as if he's still here with us, but we know we have to let go. Roger, the Lord saw your exceptional determination to fight and said, "It's time to come home now, my warrior. You must now rest, enjoy my peace, and receive my rewards. You have accomplished much and have realized your mission and purpose in life. Farewell, Roger. You will forever be our loving and unforgettable brother. May your soul rest in peace."
That was a tribute there from his brother, Winston Clarke, and that will be followed by one from Helene Witton Clarke, his daughter-in-law. Of course, the Clarke family is represented here by not only his widow, but also several of his siblings. And Helene Witton Clarke, his daughter-in-law, is accompanied.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Helen Whitehorn Clarke. I'm the daughter-in-law of our beloved Roger Clarke. And today I am honored to stand here on behalf of his children and his grandchildren. His son, Andrew, my husband of 20 years. His daughter, Dolet. Dylan, his grandson in New York. Tony Ann, his granddaughter in Florida. Stephen, his grandson, in Florida, and Ariel here in Jamaica, his granddaughter. And I'm very proud to unequivocally declare our love for our beloved dad and grandpa. Like everyone, it took us by surprise. The events over the past couple of weeks resulting in dad's sudden passing. However, we have with us a wealth of memories upon which to draw and from which to seek comfort. We remember the humor and the mischief. We remember the serious times when he went into minister mode. We remember his determined efforts to serve and the love he showed us. And we are heartened and we are overjoyed to know that he did live a very full and productive life. Dolet, his daughter, voiced the sentiments of his children as she noted in a short remembrance. And she wrote, and here I quote, "My dad, my gentle giant, never raised his voice at me, never gave me a flogging, just one look and that was enough. Dad never knew how to take a break, how to take some time to rest. So now, Dad, rest. You got tired. You take care. And as you always say to me, you okay, baby? Until then." This small blurb by Dolet epitomizes the kind of person our dear dad was. He never insulted anyone overtly. He never sought confrontation. He never reveled or rejoiced in anyone else's pain. Well, except when it came to dominoes. As the saying goes, behind every great man is an even greater woman, rolling her eyes, you know, saying, "Lord have mercy." Mrs. Sonia Clarke, or Mom, you have been Dad's rock of Gibraltar, his confidant, his heartstring. You have been his darling sons for over 37 years, always at his side and yet sometimes behind the scenes, always ensuring that he's ready to face the world. Mom, we thank you for your fortitude throughout the years, and rest assured, we will always be at your side as we remember him, Dad, with love and devotion forever. And you know, even when Dad was in the hospital in Florida, he needed her comfort so much that he insisted that she lies in the hospital bed right next to him. She shared that with me yesterday. And she said, one morning, the nurse came in a little earlier than usual and caught them in the hospital bed. And then the nurse said, "Mr. Clarke, it seems I'll have to check your blood pressure right away." She told me. Mom, you have stood by his side through thick and through thin. Rest assured, we, your children, will do the same. We love you so much. As for me, his daughter-in-law, My husband, my children, and I will always remember Dad fondly. I can recall in particular the last few weeks of his life where he spent with us in Florida just before his passing. I recall his quick wit and his sense of humor. His very calm demeanor, his reassuring spirit, his ability to make you feel that you're the most important person in his world. In particular, I can recall his very astute wisdom. A very, very wise man he was. 3 weeks before he passed, I remember very clearly, when he turned to his son, his only son, Andrew, and he said, "Andrew, thank you for marrying Helen." A very, very wise man indeed. His grandchildren have always been central to his life. Dylan, Tonian, Stephen, Ariel. And for his grandchildren, he was a shining example of greatness tempered by humility. What he taught these young children, in addition to the countless other children he loved and cared for, was that with great power comes great responsibility. A legacy, sir, we, your children and grandchildren, will strive to emulate and perpetuate in the years to come. I must interject here and say, it's just so gratifying to see Dad receive the prayers and the ministry of my pastor and my church in Florida, Pastor Herbin Green of the Metropolitan Baptist Church, and the entire congregation had prayed with him just before surgery. They had prayers throughout the day of his surgery. Pastor Green went to visit him in the hospital and post-surgery. And you know, they were always there praying with us, watching his steady progress, when suddenly he was gone. And again, I spoke with Pastor Green, and he did assure me that with his ministering to Dad, he knows his soul. His soul will rest in peace with Jesus. In preparing this tribute, we came across a very well-known poem that captures, we believe, the very essence of our beloved Dad. If you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too, if you can wait and not be tired by waiting or being lied about, don't deal in lies, or being hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good nor talk too wise. If you can dream and not make dreams your master, if you think and not make thoughts your aim, if you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat those two imposters just the same, if you can bear to hear the truth you have spoken twisted, my knaves, to make a trap for fools, or watch the things you gave your life to broken and stoop and build them up with worn out tools. If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings and not lose the common touch, if neither foes nor loving friend can hurt you, and if all men count with you, but none too much, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it. And, which is more, you will be a man, my son. Clearly the writer, Rudyard Kipling, must have known Dad personally. And what a great, great man he was. In closing, I'd like to say, as Paul says in Romans chapter 12, if our gift is to speak God's message, we should do it according to the faith that we have. If it is to serve, we should serve. Dad, Grandpa, indeed, you have served your family, your children, your country, the world, faithfully, with honor, with integrity, and with love. Dad, we salute you. Godspeed. Thank you.
And that was a most emotional and fitting tribute to Roger Clarke, delivered by his daughter-in-law, Helen Whitehorn Clarke, wife to Andrew Clarke, Roger Clark's only son.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Prime Minister of Jamaica.
Mrs. Clarke was flanked by Andrew and Dolette, and we now hear from our Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Portia Simpson Miller.
Let me begin by thanking Mrs. Clarke for preparing me to do this tribute. When I went to her, she looked at me, she said, "We are not going to cry today. You are to laugh. You are to smile." And so now, I look on Sons and I give you the smile. A man with an undying love for Jamaica, champion farmer, special person, an example to politicians, a giant of a man, an affable leader, a gentle giant, a colorful politician, a man for all seasons, a phenomenal Jamaican patriot. These are but a few of the accolades that have been publicly bestowed upon the memory of my dear friend, defender, and comrade, my colleague, the Honorable Roger Clarke. Even those words and more are inadequate to fill the empty space in the worlds and hearts of his family, his friends, his colleagues, and his constituents. Unique friend, one of a kind, invaluable nation builder, exceptional servant of the people. If only the writing of these words and the meaning of these magnificent metaphors could console Jamaicans of every political persuasion and economic standing who are yet to come to terms with the fact that Roger will speak with us no more, laugh with us no more. His passing has left an entire nation in mourning. The outpouring of love from across the nation, even across political divides, is such that Jamaica has never seen before. To Roger's eternal honor, he cultivated, tended, nourished, and cherished real and lasting friendships on both sides of the parliamentary aisle. He cemented bonds of trust and respect through his fairness and his hatred of any kind of political victimization. These bonds are unbreakable, even in his passing, and remain lessons to all of us who remain. The nation's grief has reverberated across the Caribbean Sea, stirring the emotions of our neighbors and friends whose lives Roger touched in a uniquely personal way. Toiling from the 1970s in the trenches of Northeast St. Elizabeth for the political party which shared his vision of progress for the masses, Roger Clarke dedicated nearly all his life to political and public service. He knew the importance of political apprenticeship and the virtue of waiting for the right time to shine. While he waited in the early years of his career, he was working and preparing himself. He mastered the art of politics, serving others and making others look good. His stewardship as counselor for the Balaclava Division of the St. Elizabeth Parish Council and as mayor of Black River stands tall even to this day. On September 24, 1991, following his victory in the by-election of September 16, he stamped his unmistakable mark on the Parliament of Jamaica from day one. His maiden parliamentary utterances and every intervention since are remembered for their insightfulness, candor, and great humor. Roger Clarke knew that the true test of an excellent member of parliament or as minister of local government came from first-hand knowledge of the people's community concerns. However, it was as Minister of Agriculture that Roger Clarke stood tallest. Being the farmer's minister, Roger Clarke was inseparable from the portfolio he led so astutely. As a countryman, Roger was always proud of his roots. As a man of the soil, he had few farming equals. He had spent nearly all his adult life experiencing both the frustrations and the exhilaration that came with his exposure to every aspect of agriculture. Learned as a farmer and as a farm manager of the Appleton Estate. In his capacity as Busher Clarke, he sharpened skills that would later make him the most consummate communicator in the party and the government. As Minister of Agriculture, Roger lobbied and worked tirelessly for the farmers of Jamaica. His passion was rural development, and he saw agriculture as that great wave with the potential to lift great masses of our people out of poverty. It is a living memorial to him and his excellent stewardship that, despite the odds and the challenges, agriculture is now on a major upswing. The agro parks are bearing fruit for farmers. There has been successive quarters of growth in the sector. He brought greater numbers of youth into agriculture, and he gave unflinching support to the 4-H movement, which was special to him. These are only a small number of the several promises that were kept, sealed, and delivered by him. In politics, Roger Clarke will be remembered for his fierce party loyalty, competitive spirit, rich campaign humor, and his calming presence in the midst of political tension. Roger could read the political temperature locally and nationally with remarkable precision. The entire membership of the People's National Party that he loved and to which he devoted so much of his life remained distraught but resolute, determined to continue on the trail he blazed. It was a trail of service above self and the dignity and honor that spring so naturally from his life. The substance of his work in the constituencies of Northeast St. Elizabeth and Central Westmoreland will be monuments to his memory. In memory of his sterling service as chairman of the Coffee's Well Group in Silo, organizer, campaign manager, counselor, mayor, MP, minister, vice president, and Vice President Emeritus, today we temper our sorrow with gratitude. In the Parliament, in the Cabinet, in the Executive of the Party, in the National Executive Council, Roger Clarke was one of my best political allies. This man among men was my political guardian. He was my guardian angel and defender, and he made no secret of it. I thank him for believing in me, for loving me, and for supporting me, and was always there for me. No wonder, when he was going for surgery, he called Minister Kelly, and he said to him, "Speak to PM, I want you to hold down my portfolio until I return." Little did Kellyan know, he was preparing him to be my guardian angel while he will rest peacefully with his maker. Against the odds, in good times and bad, I could count on him for support, his wise counsel and willing advice. That advice was always grounded in a fundamental knowledge of the issues, his abundance of common sense, and an intrinsic understanding of the Jamaican people. Roger, you were my sunshine on many rainy days, and my anchor through many political storms. Who now will bring the simple people-centered analysis, that analysis, to our discussions, the people's perspectives to our debates, the wry wit and infectious humor to our meetings, the parliament, and to the campaign trail? Who can make us laugh as heartily? Who can be as spontaneous and as bold? Who has the disarming charm, the political intelligence, warmth of character, and the magnanimous spirit to get away with it? Or the resilience to cope with any possible backlash? Sometimes some thought he was too frank and open. What is irrefutable is that he was straightforward and forthright. When necessary, he had an exterior of iron and steel. Yet he was a sweet soul, a gentle giant, and a gentleman who was generous to a fault. His disagreements were never personal, and his arguments never divisive. What invaluable lessons in humility, what tutorials in selfless service were encompassed in the life of this one man. More than anything, Roger Clarke enjoyed life and laughter. The happy and outgoing man was never afraid to poke good-natured fun at anyone, including ever so often at himself. He boasted frequently about his dancing abilities, even if they could or were a figment of his imagination. No one had to tease him about chicken back, oxtail, or the bowls of rice, and that he was seen repeatedly devouring in newspaper cartoons. He would tease himself. Who can forget him using one phone to answer another? That act will remain in our memories as a lasting representation of Jamaica's technology, the revolution of the late 20th century. In his unforgettable style, Roger would remind us frequently that one could be a true cane farmer or a good farm manager at Appleton without developing a lifelong association with the good spirits for which he was known. As it was in life, so it is in death. Wherever they are, one can only imagine the uncontained merriment and riotous laughter that will characterize a meeting of Roger Harold Clifford Clarke and his longtime friend, Donald Barrington Buchanan. Our recollection of his jokes still brings us smiles and uncontrollable laughter amidst our grief. That broad, mischievous, and infectious grin on his kind face will be etched indelible in our memory. As we reach for the smiling rainbow in the rich texture of your life, I extend my sincere, heartfelt sympathies to his dear, supportive wife, Sonia. He always said to me, Sonia, he always did this to me. Girl of my dreams, you see my wife? She's a one of a kind. I love her. She's the best wife that one could ever have. Sonia, he loved you with all his heart, his soul, his mind, and his body. Take it from the girl of his dreams. And I want to extend sympathies to his son and other members of the family. On behalf of a grateful nation, I thank you for sharing him so generously with us. The national and international consensus is he served his country with distinction. My brother, my comrade, my friend, my defender. In the words of an unknown poet, our master has taken you from us, and our pain will a lifetime last. Your memory will never escape us, but make us glad for times now past. Your face will always be hidden deep inside our hearts. Each precious moment you gave us shall never, ever depart. So go and run free with the angels. as they sing so tenderly. And please be sure to tell them to take good care of you for me. Walk good, my friend, my brother, my comrade, my defender, my protector. Sleep well, and may the light of the Lord shine graciously and mercifully on your gentle, caring soul as the angels gently take you home. And may you be greeted on the other side with the sweet, sweet sound of the celestial trumpet. Thank you.
Prime Minister Portia Simpson Miller giving her tribute there to her colleague and the man who told her she was the girl of his dreams, bringing a certain degree of smiles and laughter to this very somber occasion as we say final farewell to Roger Clarke. Next up will be the remembrance, and this will be delivered by his...
We strive to commit each one for memory.
Prime Minister P.J. Patterson.
To each is attached a glimpse of his face. To each a revelation, a key to his infinity. A recitation of his several names is a single shining chain binding him to us. Round perfect is the moon's face. We stand in the circle of light that is him. Roger Harold Clifford Clarke has proven the impossible. For large as he was in life, he has proven to be even larger in death. The strong sense of irreparable loss to all Jamaica and the massive outpouring of genuine admiration reflect a crossing of the divide of politics, of social class, of color, and creed. The widespread recognition and esteem of the worth and work of this gentle giant springs from a narrative which spans the bridges of a humble beginning, the steadfast pursuit of acquiring knowledge in his early passage from boyhood rule, an industrious and diligent application in the theater of work engagements, and then to the arena of public service for the building of our nation and the betterment of all its people. Roger Clarke was not a son of the gentry. His first childhood steps were not far from here, where 2 years before the eruption of workers at Froome and the persistent conflicts between the barons of the sugar estates and those who labored in the cane fields fashioned the social environment in which he was born and grown. Under the tutelage of teacher Edgar Morley at Williamsfield Elementary School, his classmates remember him as a very attentive, focused, well-behaved, and brilliant student. Having passed the second year Jamaica local, he rode his bicycle from his home at Glenelly to the Mannings High School, a distance of over 10 miles, and back home after school every day. He was never late for school. No wonder he developed such a respect for time. He was always accessible and one who addressed the concerns of his constituents and the agents of sectoral interests promptly. His contemporaries remember him as a slim and trim student, bolt-like in frame, a jovial individual who displayed respect and kindness to all. Even though he was quiet, steady, and focused, not surprisingly, he was given to boyish pranks. On more than one occasion, he was at the receiving end of the rod of that legendary headmaster, L.A. Prescott. What is not so well known is that he represented Mannings at cricket. I've searched long and hard to find something about his batting record, but I have not yet been successful. I am, however, reliably informed that on the day of a match, his cousin came with an urgent message from his mother. When he was told that Roger had just gone out to bat, he said, "I can wait. He will soon be back." Having, as a young child, helped his parents and grandparents on their farm in Williamsfield, growing a variety of root crops and vegetables, his deep interest in agriculture was evident from then. His uncle, William Jenner, himself a huge sugarcane planter, arranged his first job as an overseer of a sugar plantation owned by Hugh Fraser. He did such an excellent job there, and his talents were so quickly recognized that he was immediately recruited for Appleton Estate. It was there I first met Roger Clarke when serving my own political apprenticeship as a political organizer in St. Elizabeth. Roger Clarke was the eager beaver in Northeast St. Elizabeth, dashing from meeting to meeting in his Ford Falcon, always in high platform demand, full of humor and giving stories to compel attention, sometimes in colorful language that they could all understand, but mostly inappropriate for church play. Whenever Sonia traveled with him, the glint in his eyes betrayed the feelings of affection. He was always in a rush to leave after his final platform speaking engagement when she was around. To the very end, she stood beside him as he gasped his last breath. To Sonia, the children, his siblings, and all members of the bereaved family, I quote from a poem by C. Day Lewis. Perhaps it is roughly saying what God alone would perfectly show, how childhood begins with walking away, and love is proved in the letting go. His work at the grassroots levels, from the trenches and through the ranks of the People's National Party, prepared him fully for the invaluable contribution he was subsequently to make all over the island in party campaigning and organization. He treated everyone with respect and never committed the cardinal sin to talk down to the countryman or patronize poor urban folk. Believing in farming and committed to expanding opportunities for people, he invested in the industry, putting his experience to greater use and thereby securing his financial independence. Roger Clarke was the only caller who could make Mutty Perkins stumble and stutter on air. Who can forget his conversation with Mutty when a certain lady called his radio talk show to berate him, soon after I had appointed him as Minister of Agriculture. By the time she hung up the phone, Roger was on the line. He said to Mutti, "Let us begin with a word of prayer for that lady." He went on to explain that is someone whom he knew very well, but who unfortunately had gone astray and taken up one of the oldest vocations known to women. Because he had declined her advances and reprimanded her firmly, she had not taken kindly to his censure, hence her reprobation of him. Needless to say, that lady never called Mutti Perkins again. He did not conceal his passion to enjoy the pleasures of life. Always eager to share the blessings of hard, honest work with his family and friends. It was at Appleton he fashioned a discerning taste for the fermented and distilled product of the sugarcane, including how to sample and handle copious quantities of a rum bearing the name of the derriere of the John Crow. Within that gargantuan frame, there was barely hidden a treasure trove of kindness, of goodness, of boldness. His ebullient displays would at times be a faint cover to disguise the beat of an emollient heart within. There's a story of a small farmer who, having saved a certain amount of money, sent Roger a message that he wanted to purchase a cow. In short order, the transaction was completed, and the delighted farmer obtained a heifer in calf, two animals for the single sum of money he had made available. Roger Clarke leaves a legacy of goodwill, decency, hard work, and major accomplishments which the passage of time should not erase. The celebration of his life is a reminder for all of us that the time has come for us to recognize that national service takes many forms. Imperfection is a feature of all human life. It is not confined to those who render political service. It is my fervent hope that in our reflection on the life of this Jamaican icon, we can begin to change our attitude to political engagement. He molded a template for practitioners in the art of politics. A fitting measure in Roger's memory demands that we cease to vilify all our political leaders, to lump them together as a class or gang who are inimical to the national well-being, and then wait until they die to praise them lavishly for their national contribution. Roger Clarke firmly rejected the notion that service to the nation is incompatible with fierce loyalty to a party in whose principles he believed. He was a formidable competitor who enjoyed the art of a vigorous political duel, but he did so always without rancor and devoid of malice. He was articulate, witty, a master of political repartee, as both his party colleagues and those on the other side can confirm. He knew, whether as a member of parliament or minister in the cabinet, He was there to provide service for all, devoid of partisan cronyism or discriminatory treatment. Not only his opponents suffered by his wit at the political hustings. The story is told of him waking up in the night to a man rummaging through his clothes closet. He called out, "Man, why you are doing my room?" The man replied, "Hush up, a money may I look." Roger retorted, "But if I can't find it by day, how you going to find it by night?" And then he went on, "Wait a minute, may I come help you look?" Needless to say, the burglar disappeared in a hurry. He was great at weddings, and not just political events. He was the MC at a wedding, and the groom, in his reply on behalf of his bride and himself, said, "This is a marriage made in heaven." Whereupon Roger exploded, "Careful, my boy, so is thunder and lightning." Roger's extraordinary impact on Jamaican society owed a great deal to the fact that Roger knew himself and was confident in that self-knowledge. He did not need to seek the affirmation of the great and the powerful. He was never awed by the high and the mighty, but always maintained the common touch. Whether he was in the corridors of power or the chambers of arduous negotiations, Roger Clarke had his own way of making his presence felt. A lot has been said about his stewardship as the Minister of Agriculture. There is a foreign dimension, and the Minister of Agriculture for Barbados is here to attest to that. He was well loved and respected internationally in the various fora in which he interacted, be it AICA, FAO, EU, CARICOM, ISO, or any of the many other agencies where he had to represent our case. I know why he liked the moniker Red Pole Bull. Dr. Leckie had done a breakthrough in the field of genetics. Roger broke new ground in the way he related to comrades and laborites alike, from the estate owner to the backyard farmer, from the doctors in agriculture to the coconut man. He created a new breed in politics. There was no other like him. The cabinet has lost the wisdom of one who fully understood the psyche of the common man. I know how much the Prime Minister will miss his sage counsel and steadfast support. But we need to move beyond the sense of loss, the wealth and warmth of sincere tributes, and take effective steps to honor him in our emulation of all that was good and great about this man. Roger Clarke created his own unique and distinctive brand. He leaves behind indelible and large footprints on the sands of time. The eclectic mix of today's congregation in this church and the streets of Savlamar is irrefutable evidence that there is far more which unites us as a people than that which separates us. And so we remember him today as one who found the common denominator of patriotism that can bind us all, irrespective of green and orange, of age, gender, or color of skin. Let his outstanding achievements and his more extraordinary personal qualities inspire his political colleagues on both sides of the aisle. Let the current and future aspirants to the race learn from him, and crucially, the general population. Let his epitaph be an influence on the leaders of our country in politics, religion, business, the professions, and civic leaders to rise above those patterns of behavior which alienate us and diminish us as a people. Let Rosa's life encourage us to build rather than to tear down, to show true respect for all, and to make Jamaica a more united, more generous, and more productive country, because we, all like him, came to understand ourselves, that we accepted our responsibilities, and we did what we should in the best way we could. The many good deeds he has done, his exemplary service and devotion to the land of his birth, will live long after him. May whatever human frailties or shortcomings he revealed during his earthly sojourn be blotted from our memory with the passage of time. Walk good, my brother, as you bring a welcome sense of mirth and comradeship to the celestial kingdom where peace and life eternal abound.
Former Prime Minister, the Most Honorable P.J. Patterson, completing the remembrance to the late Roger Harold Clifford Clarke, the official funeral.
Thank you very much.
Continues now.
Honorable P.J. Patterson and all previous speakers.
A musical.
I didn't have to reprimand you much.
And
I allowed for a little leniency, especially when the family had to speak. You just have to allow them to speak. The rector of the church, the Reverend Father Leroy Johnson, has a word. Father Johnson.
We now pause for acknowledgement and salutation. We salute the following persons present: Mrs. Sonia Clarke and members of the Clarke family, His Excellency, the Most Honorable Sir Patrick Allen, Governor General, the Most Honorable Portia Sims Miller, Prime Minister, and the Most Honorable Mr. Errol Miller, Mr. Andrew Holness, Leader of the Opposition, and Mrs. Holness, members of the Cabinet, the Honorable V. Alfred Gray, Minister of Agriculture, Marine Resources and Local Government, the Bahamas, and other members of the delegation from the Bahamas, Senator Floyd Morris, President of the Senate, and Mrs. Morris, the Honorable Michael Peart, Speaker of the House of Representatives, and Mrs. Peart, the Most Honorable P.J. Patterson, former Prime Minister, Mr. Bruce Golding, former Prime Minister, and Mrs. Golding, the Honorable Mrs. Justice Vivian Harris, representing the Chief Justice, members of the state, ministers of state, sorry, the Honorable Douglas Saunders, Cabinet Secretary, members of the Diplomatic Corps, members of the Consular Corps, members of the Senate and the House of Representatives, permanent secretaries, Major General Anthony Anderson, Chief of Defense Staff, Mr. Glenmore Hines, Acting Commissioner of Police, members of the private sector, friends and colleagues, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I salute you. Thank you.
And that was the rector of St. George's Church, the Reverend Leroy
Johnson. Good afternoon, everyone.
Greeting
God saw it fit
in the church
to call his servant home. And any moment can be our moment. If there isn't anything else in life that is sure, we can be assured that death is very sure. Roger's midnight hour came, and he had to go. It's my encouragement to all of us that we live ready so that when our hour comes, we will be ready to go. Be blessed as I minister this song to you. The sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call. At the midnight cry, we'll be going home. Are you ready when Jesus steps out? Children, the dead in Christ shall rise to meet him in the air, and then those that remain shall be quickly changed. We'll be going home. You better get ready right now. I look around me and I see prophecies fulfilling. Oh, yes it is. And the signs of the time, they're appearing everywhere. Oh, I can almost hear the Father as he said, son, go get my children, take them home to me. At the midnight cry, because the midnight cry.
God bless you.
A powerful tribute by Anne Marie Lang for a man who has left an incredible mark on this country. And now we see members of the clergy ahead of the casket. The bearer party furnished by the Jamaica Constabulary Force will now take the casket further into the St. George's Church here on Great George Street in Savlamar. The casket is 16 gauge steel metal with swinging handlebars that can accommodate 8 pallbearers. The inside is lined with soft off-white velvet, and we now anticipate that movement down the aisle, and the congregation here, persons are on their feet.
Please stand, everyone.
As the sentences are delivered by members of the clergy, led by
Jesus
the Right
said,
Reverend Robert Thompson,
I am
the Reverend
resurrection.
Canon, the Honorable Hartley Perrin,
and I am the life.
Father Leroy Johnson, the Honorable Reverend
he
Robert
who
Flint,
believes in me, though he
Reverend
dies.
Carl Henlin, Reverend Dr.
Yet shall he live.
Blair, Reverend Terry Gillette,
and
Reverend
whoever
Paulette
lives
White,
and believes and in me,
Reverend Dr. Garnett
shall
Brown.
Never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed.
Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into this world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away.
And
blessed be
leading
the
bearer party,
the eternal God is our refuge.
The insignia bearer, woman, Corporal K. Bentley, and she leads the bearer party, furnished by constables of the Jamaica Constabulary Force. The commander of the bearer party is Inspector O. James, and he is walking immediately in front of the bearer party. And I should let you know that the bearer party is responsible for the movement and the protection of the body in transit and at locations. So persons who would have been at any of the three locations where viewing of the body of Roger Clarke was held on Thursday and yesterday at the Manning School in Westmoreland and in St. Elizabeth would have seen members of the Jamaica Constabulary Force who were responsible for protecting and managing that process. Now, the insignia bearer, woman Corporal Kay Bentley, is in the middle of your screen, and she is bearing the insignia of the Order of Distinction Commander Class, which was conferred on the late Roger Clarke, Member of Parliament, in 2012 for his service to the Parliament.
And at this point, we will now really be handing things over to those in charge of the religious part of this service, which has been going on since 10:30 this morning. We started on time, and the tribute took maybe the better part of 2 hours. But from now on, it will be strictly the clergy that will be conducting affairs. And for those who have just joined us, you missed tributes by the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Agriculture, Donovan Stanbury, Councillor Paul Wilson of the Westmoreland Parish Council, the Mayor of Black River, Councillor Everton Fisher, Carl Samuda representing the Jamaica Labour Party, Robert Pickersgill representing the People's National Party. There are also tributes by members of the Clarke family and a special reflection by the Prime Minister, Portia Simpson Miller, and the remembrance by former Prime Minister, the Most Honorable P.J. Patterson, who brought a lot of laughter, I must say, and wit to his presentation, as Roger Clarke would have most likely enjoyed.
He would have had it no other way, Errol. And what I found instructive was the Prime Minister's comments. Roger Clarke's widow, Sonia, told her there are to be no tears, no crying today. And she said she would remain true to that. And she did.
And she delivered a smile.
Yes, her tribute was moving, and it was a heartfelt expression of her love for Roger Clarke, as was the case for all the other persons who gave tributes. I thought it was especially touching when we heard from Helen Whitehorn Clarke, the daughter-in-law of Roger Clarke, flanked by her husband,
with faith in Jesus,
the only
Christ,
son of Roger Clarke, Andrew, and his sister, Dolette.
Yes. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit.
Will continue.
Let us therefore with confidence pray to God, our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother, Roger Harold Clifford, and we thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until, by your call, we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the work thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, sings my song, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my song, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. But when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away our sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how when Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant Roger, and we pray that having opened to him the gates of larger life, you will receive him more and more into your joyful service, that with all who have served you in the past, he may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ, O Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Governor General, the Most Honorable Sir Patrick Allen, will read the first lesson.
A reading from the Word of God. Job 19, verses 21 through to 27. Have mercy on me, my friends, have mercy, for the hand of God has struck me. Must you also persecute me like God does? Haven't you chewed me up enough? Oh, that my words could be recorded. Oh, that they could be inscribed on a monument carved with an iron chisel and filled with lead, engraved forever in the rock. But as for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and he will stand upon the earth at last. And after my body has decayed, yet in my spirit I will see God. I will see him for myself. Yes, I will see him with mine own eyes. I am overwhelmed at the thought. The word of the Lord.
The quiet waters by. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives,
he lives within my heart.
My soul he doth
restore again, and me to what doth make within.
Righteousness before his own name's sake. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives,
he lives within my heart.
Yea, though I
walk in death's dark veil, yet will I fear no ill.
For thou art with me and thy rod and staff me comfort still. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer, yes, he lives. He lives,
he lives within my heart.
Thou hast furnished in presence of my foes. My head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup overflows. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer, yes, he lives. He lives, he lives. Lives within my heart. Goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me, and in God's house forevermore my dwelling place shall be. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that Redeemer, yes, he lives, he lives,
he lives within my heart.
And in case you're just joining us, we are coming to you live from St. George's Church in the heart of Savlamar, Westmorland, for the official
funeral
of the late agricultural
minister, taken from Romans Clarke. Chapter
Andrew 8, Holness, leader of the opposition,
verses
now
14
the
to 19,
reading.
34 to 35, 37 to 39. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. Who is he that condemneth? Is it Christ that died? Yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of God.
That was the leader of the opposition, Andrew Honus, reading the second lesson. And now the congregation will stand for Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to Thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is Thy faithfulness. Share and to guide strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by Lord, unto me.
The Reverend Carl Henlin, pastor of the Gregory Park Circuit of Baptist Churches, will
My
now
brothers
deliver
and
the sermon.
Sisters, allow me first of all to express words of condolence to the members of the bereaved family, Sonia, children, other members of the family, colleagues in the political directorate, friends who especially mourn our brother's passing today. I offer these words on behalf of the wider Jamaica Baptist Union family. Many of us would know that our sister Sonia serves as one of our outstanding leaders in our congregation, and we assure both her and the family today that we have been standing with you, that we have been standing in solidarity with you, and that you have the assurance of our continued prayer. And we pray that you would lay hold upon the words of Scripture. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. And may all of us be comforted today to know that our brother lived a full and large life. And it has been said before, may those of us who serve in this country draw inspiration from the quality of his service, so that Jamaica and all our lives may become the better for it. This service has offered to us already many moments for reflection on the journey of the human life and the varied experiences which come with it. The tributes offered have celebrated the peculiar approach and the perspective upon life that our brother Honorable Roger Clarke had. And the recollections today have stirred us with delight and with gladness. And no doubt those who mourn his passing most deeply have been comforted. The truth be told, a service like this one can never be contented merely to offer accolades and tributes to the one in whose honor we have gathered. This service also invites all of us to contemplate many themes which accompany our common lives. No doubt, as we gather today, we are being inspired to contemplate our own mortality. But more than that, we are being challenged to contemplate the quality of our relationships, the sincerity of our commitments, the nature and impact and influence of our service, and the worldview which fuels and influences the decisions we make and the courses we take. Because this service is a service of Christian worship, we are also invited to consider our lives in light of the Christian grand story, to consider our grief, to consider our loss, to consider our hopes, yea, our ambitions and our strivings, in the light of the teachings and the values of the Christian faith. In that regard, today, I use as a text for our edification, and a text for our challenge, and a text for our assurance, words found in the book of the Psalms. The book of the Psalms, number 56, and verse 3 says this: when I am afraid, I will trust in God. So simple, so easy to recall. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in God. The strong warrior King David, powerful, almost invincible, celebrated by his peers, respected by his foes, comes to a moment in his life when he is brought low. David, the mighty king, has been brought low. His foes, his enemies gather around him as if to pounce upon him. And David, in his reflection, could only but utter words of our text today. When I am afraid, I will trust in God. And the truth is today that whatever else we make of these few words, these words reflect and present to us the essence of the common characteristics which mark our human existence, whether we admit it or not. The truth is, human life, lived in a context like this one, human life seriously reflected upon, discovers and admits that so often fear, dread, anxiety, uncertainty molests and shadows our lives. And when we think about our lives today, 21st century Jamaica, and when we contrast it with the world in which David the king lived, we wonder, what could David fear? Was it only the immediate threat upon his life? Not so. Certainly, those who lived in David's era and who would later preserve this psalm were never under the attack of terrorism nor marauding gunmen. Those who lived in David's time never had to contemplate their daily existence with the shadow of a devaluing dollar and an economy that was enough to cause fear. They had no cable television, which would broadcast 24/7 scary news, threatening news, and they never lived under the threat of nuclear accidents. Yet it was true that life for them in an ancient past was marked by continued fear, dread, and anxiety. They feared the threat of their enemies who would come in upon them and destroy their lives. They feared those who would rob their livelihood. So the psalmist says, when my enemies came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. In David's era, they feared famine and starvation and hardship. They feared what we fear, sickness and death. As a religious people, they feared the mockery of the scornful and the wicked. They knew that human life, lived and experienced its passages of time under the threats which made them fearful, scareful, scary, and vulnerable. The truth is, this psalm speaks to us firstly of this, the inevitability of fear. These scriptures and the psalms never invite us who read them and who listen to them to escapism or pretense or hypocrisy. Instead, the scriptures represent ordinary human life and human experiencing, seeking to make sense of God in the midst of the threatening shadows of life. So the scriptures embody for us the journey of a people like as we are, who are attempting to make sense of the vagaries and the vicissitudes of life in the midst of the sure knowledge of the reality of God. And yet with all of that, the psalmist is never afraid nor ashamed to say, when I feel afraid. For the psalmist knows what you know. The psalmist knows what I know. That fear is never an emotion to simply wish away. The psalmist knows that fear is never an experience simply to avoid as if it does not exist. The psalmist knows that fear shadows the human experience and molests the human mind. When I feel afraid, what causes fear? It is perhaps this. We are uncertain about an unknown future. Or else, for some of us, we feel a sense of guilt and shame about a known past. Or for others of us, we sense a feeling of inadequacy to meet the challenges of the present moment. You are here this morning, and because we have gathered in the midst of the reality of death, every one of us has been forced to contemplate not only the journey of our lives, but truthfully, we are contemplating the onset of our own death. And because we are human beings, frail as we are, because we are human beings made of flesh as we are, sometimes, this thing called fear marks our existence. And what of those of us who have heard in recent days of illness and disease which has come upon us? And what of those of us who are experiencing lingering pain in our bodies, perhaps in our backs? And when we think about it, we have this sense that our end, the sureness of our end, is being intensified. Do not be afraid or ashamed to admit that there are times when we feel afraid. And yet it is true that when human beings sense this fear, this dread, this anxiety, this uncertainty, human beings always offer a response. We're always seeking something to calm our fears. We're always seeking something to soothe our fears. We're always seeking something for which to clutch at, as if to seek some kind of refuge, something to hold on to when fear molests and when fear shadows. We human beings know that we often need something or someone on which and to which we can turn. Truth be told, human beings are adept of seeking this kind of refuge. And some people become addicted to all kinds of substances, drink, and drugs, as if seeking a refuge to calm their fears. Some persons take on braggadocious personalities as if to pretend, in an effort to drive out fear, they pretend to be what they are not. Some people simply become psychologically dysfunctional and become nervous wrecks. Some people turn to spiritism, seeking to exhort the demons from among them. Some people try all kinds of escape routes. In the words of the psalmist, "Oh, if I had wings like a bird, I would fly away and be at rest." Some people turn to their own strategies of intellect and intelligence and personal insight, attempting to understand, then to explain away or to control. I am the master of my own fate. Human beings have this about us, that we are always seeking some coping mechanisms to help us deal with the fear which so easily molests our lives. This psalmist today says, "When I am afraid, what will I do? I will trust in God. I will trust in God." Who is this God of which the psalmist speaks? And who is this God of which we have sung today? And who is this God whom I present with confidence today? Who is this God? Thankfully, the words of Scripture offer us glimpses of who God is. Mere glimpses. For no human word, no human mind can properly comprehend the majesty and the mystery of who God is. But who is this God of whom the psalmist speaks? The prophet Isaiah offers us a glimpse. He says this: "Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth has been founded? This God sits enthroned above the circle of the earth. Before him, the people like us gathered are mere grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy. He spreads out his tent to live in. He brings princes to nothing, and he reduces the rulers of the world to naught. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root in the ground, than he blows on them, and they wither, and a whirlwind sweeps them away like the chaff." That is the God of whom we speak. But this God is not simply a terrifying God in whose presence we come scared to our wits. No. This God actually invites every single human being on an adventure of faith. This God invites every one of us, yea, every one of us, from the greatest to the least, on an adventure of trust. But what does it mean to trust in God? It means this. It begins with a confidence in the reality of the presence and the existence of a mighty God. Then it continues into a consciousness of the riches of the provision that God makes available for every one of us on this earthly pilgrimage. And finally, it commits itself to respond to the gracious invitation which God offers. To do what? To align our lives to the purposes of God in this world. What does it mean to trust God? It begins with a confidence that God is. It continues with a consciousness that God offers to every one of us the resources and the graces that we need to make it in life. And then that God invites us to respond to the invitation to align our lives to his purposes in the world. When that happens, this happens. When fear molests and terror threatens, when anxiety and trepidation shadows our lives, God gives to us a fresh awareness of who God is and what God is doing. God gives to us fresh abilities to meet the challenges of the day. And God gives us fresh assurances which remind us that whatever comes our way, I will never leave you nor forsake you. What is the value of this God, if you would ask? It is this. God gives us fresh awareness of who God is and turns us away from idolatry. God offers to us riches from his providence and turns us from self-centeredness. God offers to us new abilities and makes us to face life, meeting the challenges of the day with confidence. But how does it happen? I wish it could happen by a bishop casting a cloth over your head, but it doesn't happen that way. How does it happen? Many years ago, a man called Jesus appeared on the stages of the history of this world. Something about him caused some people to be spellbound and devoted. But something about him caused some people to turn away with indifference. And something about him caused some people to pursue him to his death. That Jesus remains the subject of investigation across this world. But he was more than a subject of investigation, a fascinating fellow. He was more than a tragic hero coming to a cruel death. He was this. In his life, God shone through. And through his life, God presents for us the pathway of living triumphantly, living victoriously, living purposefully in this world, which assists us to overcome fear and inspires trust. Through the life of Jesus, through the death and resurrection of Jesus, God offers to anyone who dares to entrust their lives to him that in the midst of the darkness of this world, the darkness which stalks our lives, God gives light, the light which enlightens and shows us the way, the light which exposes the sources of evil and gives us direction as we navigate our way along the treacherous pathways of life. When we trust Jesus, God does this. In the midst of the disorder and chaos which rock this world, he gives us a place of stability on which to stand. For he assures us that though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, God stands sure and secure. And Sonia and others, in the midst of your grief and loss, in the midst of your grief and loss, this Jesus, by his life, by his death, and his resurrection, fills your lives with comfort, with hope and joy. For the scriptures assure us he will wipe all tears from our eyes. What does this Jesus offer? He offers this, that in the midst of the threat of an unknown future, carrying with it the only thing that is certain, our death. God in Christ models for human beings how we can meet death with assurance. He models for us how we can face death with confidence. He models for us how we can find ourselves in the midst of death with assurance, because in Jesus, by his resurrection, death has been overcome. So I hear someone saying these words that we know, that because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fears are gone. Because I know he holds my future. My life is worth the living just because he lives. I end by saying this today. God does not magically erase our problems. There are real enemies to be faced, real problems to be encountered, real threats to meet upon. That's what life is. To live with fear is miserable. To live simply trusting in your own luck or in your own resources may well be manageable. But to live your lives trusting in God opens your life to the possibility of miracles beyond your wildest imagination. For God comes and journeys with us, assures us, befriends us, comforts us, and promises his people that ultimately all will be well. Somebody sang these words today. Words sung in a beautiful way by Frank Sinatra, regrets. I've had a few. But then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the way, and much more than this, I did it my way. I think that song speaks to the energy of the human will and determination and the confidence by which we can live our lives. But I tell you, that is not enough. Mario Lanza, playing the lead role in The Student Prince, sings this: I'll walk with God from this day on. His helping hand I lean upon. This is my prayer, my humble plea, may the Lord be ever with me. I'll walk with God. I'll take his hand. I'll talk with God. He'll understand. I pray to him each day, to him, and he hears the words that I say. His hand will guide my throne and rod, and I'll never walk alone while I walk with God. For when I feel afraid, I'll trust in God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And that was the Reverend Carl Henlin, pastor of the Gregory Park Circuit of Baptist Churches, delivering the sermon for the official funeral of the late Roger Harold Clifford Clarke, Minister of Agriculture, Member of Parliament for Central Westmorland, remembered as a friend, a father, a grandfather, a comrade, and a loyal servant of the people.
In the assurance of eternal life given at baptism, let us stand and proclaim our faith and say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Give to your church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Yes. May all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection die to sin and rise to newness of life. And may we with him pass through the gate and gate of death to a joyful resurrection. Yes. Grant to us who are still on our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days. Yes. Grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those who they love.
Yes.
Father all, we pray for Roger, Harold, Clifford, and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. May he and all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen.
And we're standing
the
by now.
The offering that is being asked of you will benefit the St. George's Anglican Church and the Balaclava Baptist Church Outreach Program. During the singing of the hymn, you may sit.
And we know that Roger Clarke would have had it no other way, having been a strong supporter of community and church. The all-age school in Williamsfield was the beneficiary of several donations from Roger Clarke.
Died he for me who caused his pain, for me who in love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? 'Tis mystery all the mortal dies. Who can explore his strange design? In vain the firstborn seraph tries to sound the depths of love divine. 'Tis mercy, oh, let earth adore, let angel minds inquire no more. 'Tis mercy, oh, let earth adore, let angel minds inquire no more. Long lives God the throne above, soul infinite his grace, emptied himself of all God's love, and bled for Adam's helpless race. This mercy, all immense and free, for whom my God it found out me. This mercy. Long my imprisoned spirit lay, fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray. I woke the dungeon flamed with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose, went forth, and followed thee. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose, went forth, and followed thee. No condemnation now I dread. Jesus and all in him is mine. Alive in him, my living head, and clothed in righteousness divine. Bold I approach the eternal throne, and claim the crown through Christ my own. Bold I and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, and soft refreshing rain. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord for all his love. He only is the maker of all things near and far. He paints the wayside flower, he lights the evening star. The winds and waves obey him, by him the birds are fed. Much more to us, his children, he gives our daily bread. All good gifts around are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord for all his love. We thank thee then, O Father, for all things bright and good. The seed time and the harvest, for life, or health and food. No except the gifts we offer, for all the love imparts.
the offering will now be presented, followed by the blessing of the offering by the Reverend Paulette Wright.
We thank thee then, O Father, for all things bright and good, the seed time and the harvest, our life, our health, and food. No gifts have we to offer for all thy loving parts, but that which thou desirest, our humble, thankful hearts. Lord, we thank you for Roger. We thank you for his life. We thank you for the impact he has had on all our lives. We thank you, Lord, for everyone who is here. And we especially thank you for the gifts that they have given. And we thank you that the outreach programs of the St. George's Anglican Church and the Balaclava Baptist Church will bring honor, glory to your name. So unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forevermore as we say thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please be seated.
And now we will be hearing from Kevin Williams, the cantor, as he will do the Holy City.
Last night I lay a-sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem, beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna to your King. Then methought my dream was changed. The streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery. The morn was cold and chill, as a shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Please join me. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark,
hark, all the angels sing.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna to your King.
Once again, the scene was changed. New earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets. The gates were open wide. And all who would might enter. And no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away.
Please stand and sing with me. You're wonderful.
Jerusalem, Jerusalem, sing, sing, for the night is o'er. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna forevermore. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna forevermore.
Praise God. And what a wonderful tenor presentation by Kevin Williams, the much loved hymn, The Holy City. As we move into the final phases of this official funeral for the late Roger Clarke here inside St. George's Anglican Church in Savlamar, Westmorland.
It is our baptism in Christ that makes it possible for us to sing with just with such joy and such hope. Our baptism is indeed the gateway to our life in Jesus Christ. As reminded a few days ago by family that he was baptized at St. James Grange, Glen Eilie, the very same church that I was baptized in a few years after he, of course. But we celebrate indeed the life that he shared, not only with his beloved Sonia, but with Jesus himself. And in light of that, I invite you to stand with me so we can participate in this act of commendation. And we will honor Roger's remains, blessing him first of all with holy water, recalling for us his baptism in Christ, and we will honor his body with incense. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant Roger with your saints.
Where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing,
life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind. And we are mortal, formed of the earth, and unto earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust. Yet even at the grave we make our song. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sign but life eternal. Let us commend our brother Raja to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Raja, O Sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set him free from every bond, that he may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen. As you quietly say your own prayers for the repose of Raja's soul, after a space, I invite you to join as we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
and lead us not into temptation.
And as we see the Right Reverend Robert Thompson officiating in this aspect of the service, the commendation and farewell.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Roger. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen.
We are indeed approaching the end of the service.
Lord, thou lettest thou thy servant depart in peace.
Immediately following which, the procession will go to Glen Eily in Williamsfield, where Roger Clarke will be laid to rest.
For my eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all thy people Israel, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, and to be the glory of thy people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
And just before await the national anthem of the song. National anthem.
It would be very remiss of us to leave here today not acknowledging the presence of our mayors, our custodians, and our hard-working counselors among us. So we salute you. Also to thank all those who have been a part of the planning and the execution of this service, too many persons to mention. And so after the national anthem, we invite the bearers party to come forward and the undertaker. Now the national anthem.
And the congregation here at the St. George's Anglican Church will now get ready for the recessional hymn, during which the bearer party will form and retrieve the caskets bearing the body of the late Roger Clarke.
Grapes of wrath restored, he has loosed the faithful lightning of his terrific swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. I've seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Today, September 34, is the referred to as Roger Clarke Day here in Westmoreland. His body will now be removed from the church and to its final resting place in Glen Eilley, Williamsfield, 14 miles from where we are, where he will be buried in the family plot beside his mother and his sister.
And as you can see, the bearer party arrow is in place, and they are led by their commander, Inspector O'Green, and we're now seeing the clergy leaving the sanctuary, and immediately behind them the bearer party will take the casket from the St. George's Church. Now the casket, as I had mentioned before, is 16 gauge steel metal with swinging handlebars and can accommodate 8 pallbearers. The inside is lined with soft off-white velvet. Now, a bit of information. The plot, Errol, is beside, the family plot is beside the Williamsfield All-Age School. And it is, in fact, we are reliably informed, an institution which Roger Clarke supported with donations of goats and chickens to the school's farm. As a matter of fact, the fencing and the gate now at the school were contributed by Roger Clarke.
And now we're observing, those of us who have a view of the casket are observing the bearer party, the way they precisely and professionally almost raise this massive casket, because Roger was a big man, and the casket is made out of steel, so it's a very heavy casket, and they have successfully put it on their shoulders, and they will bear it from this sanctuary to the waiting hearse, which took the body to the various viewings that had been arranged, Kingston, in St. Elizabeth, and here in Westmoreland, and now it is taking him to his final resting place, near to where he first entered this world, in his district, near his family plot.
And you're watching Woman Corporal Kay Bentley carrying the insignia of the Order of Distinction Commander Class, which was conferred on Roger Clarke for more than 20 years service to the Parliament of Jamaica. Immediately behind her is Inspector O. James, who is the Commander of the Bearer Party furnished by the Jamaica Constabulary Force. And Roger's family, his widow Sonia, greets the former Prime Minister PJ Patterson and other dignitaries as she and other members of the family file out of the St. George's Church to begin that 14-mile journey.
And for those who don't know Stacey, we should let them know that this particular anthem being performed now was not a part of the funeral ceremony, but Roger, having been such a foundation member of the People's National Party, I think the party members here felt obliged to perform their party anthem, the trumpet, in his honor as the body leaves the church on its way to Glen Eily for interment.
And Errol, I'm sure persons here appreciate the commitment that Roger Clarke made to the People's National Party. And we heard from even his political opponents, who spoke so effusively about his commitment to his party. Carl Samuda, who paid tribute on behalf of the Jamaica Labour Party, spoke about Roger Clarke's love for the Prime Minister, Portia Simpson Miller.
The
girl of his dreams.
And so as mourners make their way out of this church and start the trek to the burial site, what can we say? We started at 10:30 and it's now a few minutes before 2 o'clock, so it's been we're heading towards 3.5 hours.
Yes.
And so a fitting farewell to one who has given service beyond the call of duty to the people of Jamaica, and held in a part of the island where he was at the time of his passing the Member of Parliament for Central Westmoreland. What Roger Clarke will be remembered forever in the annals of Jamaican political life. I wonder if they will now convert his wall of cartoons into a mini museum.
Yes, there were many. It is a beautiful tribute, and it speaks to the closeness that the people feel towards their representative. He represented the people of Central Westmoreland. At one time, he was the mayor of Black River, and he was a champion for Jamaican farmers.
Which indeed made him unique, because very few politicians can claim to have had constituencies in two parishes in there, you know, without much of a break in transmission, so to speak.
Yes.
Because I believe the legend is that he had planned to retire, and when the 2011 election was coming up, the girl of his dreams asked him, please go down to Westmoreland and take over the seat for me, because I know you will be able to do it. And so he did. And as the chairman of the People's National Party said in his tribute, he has gone to his final rest without ever tasting political defeat. And that in itself is something for anyone.
It was a great achievement. It was a great achievement. But I consider even greater the connection that he made with the people, regardless of what side of the political divide they were on. And it shows you the remarkable nature of this Jamaican man.
And indeed his greatness. Because as we know, many politicians have a thin skin, but he never developed one. He was always able to laugh it off. And even as recently as maybe a few months before he went to Florida for this surgery on his back, which happened to have been successful. You know, it's such an ironic twist of fate that having successfully had the recovered from the surgery, he should pass on while on his way back to Jamaica to contest a race with no less a personage than Usain Bolt.
it was so humorous, you know, the way he poked fun at himself and put himself out there. He was such a confident man. Yes. And I remember him speaking at a function that the GIS covered, and hear him talk about the criticisms that he faced by persons in media, and how he laughed it off, really. And he said, regardless of what people would say about him, everywhere he goes, the people love me.
Yes, and he wasn't boasting, it was true. And what can we say about Mrs. Clarke? She has held up wonderfully.
Isn't she a remarkable woman?
Under what must be very trying circumstances. Because, you know, to have lost him that way, you know, while at the airport, you know, that really must have put a great strain on her, for her to travel back home alone instead of with her, and for her to, you know, be there at the airport to instead greet his casket with his remains. It really has, but she, I think she has made a commitment. Even her request of the Prime Minister that, you know, she didn't want any tears today or any, you know, crying and so on. She has led by example.
And there is no doubt, Errol, of the love they shared and the commitment that they had to each other when he was away having his surgery and recuperating. She was right there
in the bed.
Yes. Her daughter-in-law shared that with us, that, you know, he insisted that Sonia needed to be in the bed beside him.
And so as we bid farewell to you from the funeral service for the late Roger Clarke at the St. George's Anglican Church here in Savlamar, where it is now, I would dare say, well over 90 degrees.
Yes, it is a very sunny Saturday afternoon.
Yes, and the procession will be leaving shortly for the 14-mile journey to Glen Eily. And we will, at some other time, maybe show you pictures from that.
But
for the time being, on behalf of the team here.
Right, and Errol, we would really like to thank the members of the hardworking production team of the Jamaica Information Service. our production director, our senior production coordinator, and all of the men and women who make up the team who were here from yesterday and very early this morning were here ensuring that our viewers would be able to see and hear all of the images that came from this official funeral. Thanks also to our media colleagues who brought the images to you, our viewers, live. And on behalf of the entire technical team, I'm Stacey Ann Smith.
And I'm Errol Lee.
Sorry, I never told you all I wanted to say. And now it's too late to hold you, 'cause you've flown away, so far away.
Jamaica has lost a leader of